So what I thought I'd do this week is talk about how three notes per string scales mutate as you play into different key signatures. Now this, as a concept, is really quite useful if you want to learn how to play over modes, for example. It's a great way of thinking about playing over modes. It's also really useful if you're playing chord progressions that have key changes in them, so to understand how the shapes change as the key changes underneath it. So it's a really useful technique for jazz as well. Now I've created a PDF handout for this as well, and that's really useful. It's well worth downloading that and just having that to hand as you're going through this, because you should be able to really understand what I'm talking about if you have a look at that as well. So what I thought I'd do is firstly sort of discuss what the handout is trying to demonstrate, and then I'll talk about what I mean by using this concept to play over modes, and then I'll talk about how I apply this to play over a jazz progression. So I've picked the standard satin doll, just the first part of that, talked about how to play over the various key changes in the start of that. So let's start with the handout. So normally when you think about any position on the neck, you think about, okay, where's a root note? So if I'm playing a C major, I've got the C just there, third fret of the A string. And the position that implies is this one. Yeah. And then maybe you know the shapes relative to each other as well. So if I want to stay in the key of C major and move to the next position, it looks like that as well. Or if we want to change key, there's a G, so let's say I want to play in G major, so there it is on the fifth fret, so I use exactly the same shape as I did just there, but I just move the position up. So now I'm playing in G major. So the purpose of this chart, though, is to think about these shapes differently. This chart's laid out from the point of view of what would I do to this shape if I wanted to change the underlying key. So how would I mutate this original shape if I wanted to start playing in G major, for example? And as you can see, it's laid out in a circle, because it's very much related to the circle of fifths or the circle of fourths, but how they apply to each of the three notes per string scale shapes. And you can see in the chart, as you add more sharps to the shape, you can see how you basically move clockwise around the circle. Or if you remove sharps or add flats, you move anti-clockwise. So if I start with this first position that I'm playing in C major and I want to start playing in G major, then I move to the shape one position clockwise around from here, which is this one. So now I'm playing in G major. And really that's what the chart is showing. It's showing how each of the positions mutate when you change the key signature. Now it's not about changing the key, so in this case I'm turning from C major to G major. C's got no sharps, G's got one sharp. But if I went from C major to E minor, the movement is exactly the same in terms of this chart, because we're working with key signatures. C major's got no sharps or flats. E minor has got one sharp, just the same as G major. So the movement around a circle is exactly the same. Okay, so how does this apply to modes then? Well, modes are all about context. They're all about the scale in the context of the harmony that you're playing against. So if you can understand the relative major or the relative minor of the mode that you want to play against, if you can understand where the harmony is in relation to that, and if you can understand where the pentatonic is, for example, in relation to that, then you can use this approach to see how the scale mutates from playing that major or minor key into playing that major or minor mode. Let me see if I can demonstrate. Okay, so let's imagine I wanted to play in A Dorian. So Dorian is a minor mode, so it's related to minor keys. So what I do first is I start with a mental exercise of thinking about, okay, what do I do when I'm playing in A minor in this position? So there's my A minor chord. there's my A minor pentatonic. And my A minor scale would look like that. So at the moment I'm playing in A minor. If I wanted to play an A Dorian, what I do is I keep the same chord, I keep the same pentatonic, but the scale, because the Dorian mode has one more sharp in, I think about this circle again and then I choose the shape that has one more sharp in it, so I move one shape clockwise, which is that shape. So there's my chord again. Taken from the scale, one position more clockwise than my minor mode. Okay, so this concept is also really useful when you're playing through progressions that have key changes in them, to understand how any position is going to change as you move through the key changes, and that's really where the power of this really, really sort of fits in. So what I did was I picked the standard satin doll, just worked through the first section of that, and I'll talk about how the key changes change, and so similarly how the underlying scale shapes change when you use this kind of approach as well. So let's zoom in and I'll see if I can take you through that. Okay, so let's look at the chords to start with in satin doll. We've got D minor, 7th goes to G7, and then we've got E minor goes to A7, and then it goes to A minor 7 to D7, and then everything moves down chromatically. A flat minor 7, D flat 7, and then drops back into a C major 7th. Okay? So if we analyze those chords, what we'll see is the first two chords, D minor 7 and G7, come from the key of C major, and then E minor 7th and A7 come from the key of D major, and then we go to A minor 7th and D7th, they come from the key of G major, and then we move chromatically down to A flat minor 7th and D flat 7th, so that's from the key of G flat major. And then we're back into our original key, which is C major again, okay? So let's look at the movement of these key signatures then. We start in C major, which has no sharps or flats. Then we move to D major, which has two sharps in there. And then we move to G major, which has got one sharp in it. And then that whole shape slides down chromatically to G flat major, and then we go back to our original key again. So if you like, we've created a signature of the movement of the keys here, kind of a fingerprint for this first section of the song. So you can pick any shape, any position to start with that's in the key of C major. So let's use our old friend again from around the 5th fret. So I'm playing in C major. So now we're moving to D major, so we move two positions around that circle in that pattern. Yeah, and that now we're in D major, so we're going to G major, so that's one less sharp, so it's moving one position anti-clockwise. And then we take that whole shape and move it chromatically down, because we're in G flat major. And then we revert back to our original position. Okay. And as soon as you understand this flow of how each of these positions mutate around that circle, you find that you'll be able to take that same pattern, that same movement of shapes around this circle, and play this satin doll chord progression anywhere on the neck. And that's the real power of this particular approach. So once you understand this circle, once you understand how the key signature affects and mutates each position, then you've got all of the tools that you need to be able to play over pretty much any chord progression that uses these three notes per string scale shapes. And a good thing to do, for example, is to take the section B of Satin Doll and see if you can do the same thing yourself. And then on YouTube, there's plenty of videos with this as a backing track, some of them slowed right down. So you can really start to experiment with this in your own playing and see if you can come up with your own lines using these kinds of techniques. Anyway, that's it for this week. Have fun with it, and we'll chat next time. Goodbye.